So welcome to the second session. During this session, I will give you an introduction of the basics, how the program really works. So not on the basics, the basic physics behind that, but really how the program really works. And we'll make an online demonstration. So we'll calculate on in reality here the titanium carbide example, showing you how we operate WIEN2k via our web interface. Let me start with a few general remarks on WIEN2k. WIEN2k is a pretty different program from all the other programs on the market in that sense that it is not one single big Fortran program or code, which is then managed alone with inputs, but it consists of many smaller independent Fortran 90 programs which are linked together via C shell scripts. You may not know what is a C shell, but you maybe if you are familiar with Bash, you know, with Linux, you know the Bash shell. That's the standard Linux shell nowadays. However, at the time when WIEN2k was developed, there was no Bash around. So the C shell was at that time the most powerful shell scripting language. Also, nowadays, I must admit, it is a not so powerful language compared to Bash or even more to Python or something like this nowadays. But still, we are using C shell scripts. I will always talk about the case. So every compound we are doing is a case, and every compound you are doing should run in its own subdirectory, and I will call it the case directory. We need a file which contains the structural information about this compound which you want to calculate, and this is our master input, and this file is called case.struct. Okay? Often I will refer short and saying the struct file. Open the struct file, look at the struct file or so. That always means case.struct, and case in reality will be replaced by titanium nitride.struct, by magnesium oxide.struct, or whatever compound you are doing. The basic steps are, after you have prepared such a structure file, you initialize the calculation. The Linux command would be like this, and then you run the scf cycle, the Linux command would be like this. All those of these steps can be done in our WIEN2web interface, or, and you will have in the exercises at the end, the opportunity to try also this out, really typing it in at the command line in a terminal window, so that you can use both interfaces and get to know both interfaces. I will today demonstrate, of course, WIEN2web. Since this is for the beginner, for sure, the more simple interface. WIEN2k produces and needs many, many files, because between these different programs, the interaction or the communication is done via files. So if you do a plain LS, you may see hundreds of files and you find nothing. Therefore, our files have some logical endings to make it easier for you to find the corresponding files. That means all the input, output, or what we call also the SCF files have endings which are similar or the same as the corresponding programs. So if you find a file case output 1, that is the output file of the program LEPW1. If you find a case.IN2, it's the input file for the program LEPW2, and so on. All those input files are generated automatically, more or less, during the initialization. So you don't have to care about the individual input files in the default configurations. Of course, later on, if you get more experienced, so you may want to modify one or two numbers of these input in these inputs, and then you have to edit specifically a particular input file. We'll have this also during the exercises in a few examples. So I told you WIEN2web is based on a graphical web-based user interface. Basically, WIEN2web is a web server, a specialized web server, which one starts once on your host where you want to do the calculations. Then you connect with your browser to this web server. That would be a name of where the computer, where the web server is running, and you have to specify a high port. A port number is something like a door where you enter the specific address, let's say. And the first step is, of course, you create a new session over here, replace the session name with something, titanium carbide or so. I'll demonstrate this in the fly. Once you are there, you have defined your directories and so on. You come up with a screen similar like this, and basically you have here in the execution bar to generate the structure, to initialize the calculation, and to run the scf cycle. So these three steps are, so to say, the basic steps you have to do in every calculation. Important is, usually you would do the structure generation just once in one directory, except maybe if you want later change, let's say, lattice parameters or so, then you would do this. The same is true here. You would initialize usually only once for a given compound. I always say, so to say, never ever initialize again, because you destroy your self-consistent density and all these things. It's not necessary. However, you may run a couple of times the SCF cycle for doing different reasons. Either you have changed some input. So suppose we want to do an LDA calculation and the GGA calculation. Then I do these steps only once. I run the SCF cycle, do the LDA calculation. I would not later on do a save of these calculations. I will demonstrate that. Then I change one input file, so no initialization, just one input file, changing from LDA to GGA, and run this SCF cycle again. Once you have done the SCF, you can, in utilities, check your convergence. I'll do this with them. And then under tasks, you have then several guided tasks, how to calculate the band structure, density of states, electron density, or some spectroscopy. Okay, with this theoretical background, we switch to an online demonstration. And here I am now basically connected to our computer. I have here a terminal window, and WIEN2web is already started. If I wouldn't know if WIEN2web is started, I can simply type it in. Again. Oops. Yeah. I can simply type it in, and it would tell me, WIEN2web cannot start. It's already running because it cannot. New WIEN2web failed to bind to this port because this port is already in use. So this tells you your WIEN2web is already running. And then in this installation, you have down here a very nice buttons which you basically need. And this button over here with WIEN2k opens a web browser with the corresponding address where the computer is running. It asks you for username and password. Of course, it's web-based, so everybody from outside the world could connect to this web server eventually, so you don't want that. Therefore, you make it password protected. And then it starts out a screen like this. Here you see sessions which are already have been done. You could go again into one of those sessions, or, and this is what we will do here, you create a new one. And as I said, I want to do a titanium carbide. That's the example from the user's guide, which is in the user's guide. So I create the session. And when I create the session, it tells me, currently I'm in this directory here, in WIEN2k workshop. This is our base directory. But I don't want to store the calculation in this directory. I want to create a new directory, and it suggests to use the same name as the session name. Of course, not mandatory. If you think for some reasons you want to give it another name, you can do it, but it's not usually not. So we create this directory. Now we are in this workshop, titanium carbide, and then when I'm finished, I select the current directory and click to restart. And this is the basic screen. And of course, the first thing we have to do is let's generate a structure. Clicking on this, there are two options basically. If I would have a SIF file here, then I would get a list of SIF files in this directory. So if you have a database and you get SIF files from a known structure, copy it into this directory and then select it, and you can convert this SIF file, which is the crystallographic structure file of databases, directly into our WIEN2k structure files. Alternatively, we can generate a structure file by hand. And that's what we will do here. So for simple structures like the sodium chloride structure of titanium carbide, we do this by hand. First important thing is, how many atoms does titanium carbide have? Of course, two. So the default, I leave it as it is. If I would do PCC iron, I would change this to one. And if I do strontium titanate, I would change this to three, obviously. Okay, and it opens this template. You can put here a title if you want, or it's not mandatory, but probably you want. And the first important thing to define a structure is to define the lattice. WIEN2k offers you two possibilities. Either you tell what lattice do I have, a primitive, face-centered, body-centered, or these C-centered types, rhombohedral or hexagonal, or one of the 230 space groups. So if you know which space group your compound have, select the proper space group. For titanium carbide, I don't know it. Or I assume I don't know it, but I know sodium chloride structure is a face-centered structure, so I'm using F, okay? Then I have to put in lattice parameters. You can put it either in angstrom or in Bohr. By default, of course, usually lattice parameters are given in angstrom, but internally, if you look now in numbers directly in the struct file, they will always be in Bohr. So internally, we always work with atomic units, and these are Bohrs. So the lattice parameter of titanium carbide is about 4.3. Most conveniently, you change with the tabulator key from one window, from one input window to the next one. Don't use the mouse and click there, but change with the tab key. It's much better. The angles are 90 degrees anyway, and we have two atoms, and all we need to specify is the name of the atom, titanium, and please put in titanium exactly with the capital T and small I as the atomic symbol is. It will not recognize a small TI or a capital TI, both capital or something like this. So it's necessary that you really put it like this. If you would have in a structure many titanium atoms, you could put into this field here, titanium 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on. And the position is 0, 0, 0. I don't care about the nuclear charge set, and I don't care about the Muffin tin radius. This is this atomic sphere radius, which will be changed. Both of these numbers, the program will change and update automatically. So don't put them, just the name of the atom. Second atom is a carbon, of course, and the capital C is what we need. And here, of course, we cannot leave it at zero, but the position of this atom is 1/2. 0, 0. But I show you also what you can do in WIEN2web also. You can also do some small calculations, like 1/2. Oops, this is like this. This is in particular important for hexagonal structures, because there you should put in 1/3 or 2/3. Now, what is 1/3? 0.333 is not 1/3, okay? So put 1/3, and then the program converts it to full accuracy, all the digits it needs to really 1/3 or 2/3 or things like this. Or if you have a complicated input, you could also put it only once and then use it like X. So if I type X over here, it means I'm taking 0.5. So I could specify the position of this carbon atom as 0.5, 0.5, 0.5, like here. But since it's face-centered, I could also remove 1/2, 1/2, 0 somewhere and put only 0.5, 0, 0. This is all equivalent. I need it only to specify it once. That's the whole input. It was not so complicated. Lattice parameters, name of the atom and its position, name of the atom and its position. That's basically what it is. Once you have done this, you say save structure, and then it tells you here, do it at least once. So you should now here let the program compute the atomic sphere sizes, the sphere radii. Okay, so we click here, and again, a difficult question, namely it asks you, how much should I reduce the sphere sizes? By default, it will take nearly touching sphere sizes. But if you have touching sphere sizes, of course, you can later on not decrease the volume, because then the spheres may overlap. So you should, at the beginning, think, what do I want to do in this series or set of calculations? Is it a single step calculation? I know the experimental structure. I want to use the experimental structure and calculate the spectrum. Then use zero. Or I want to minimize the forces. That means if the positions of the atoms are free to move, they could come closer, because the experiment may not know it, or DFT gives you a different result. So then I would typically reduce this by 1 to 5%. And the same is if I want to study volume effects, that means calculate the lattice parameter, I would reduce this to, for instance, also 5%. That allows me then to generate a curve with changed volume, energy versus volume, and get some parabola from where I can get the minimum lattice parameters, minimum energy, and therefore the equilibrium lattice parameters. Okay? So here we do just, yeah, maybe we do some total energies also, then let's reduce it by 5%. Doesn't matter. Okay? So let's do it. And it comes back into the structure generator. You see it has updated the nuclear charge and the sphere sizes. And you can see the sphere sizes are not the same, but the titanium sphere is bigger than the carbon sphere. And I will later on comment why it is as it is. Okay? Take it at the moment as it is. Okay, so this is all we need to do. We save again. And so far, we worked on an intermediate file. So we have not generated the struct file. If I now would go to this button or here, it would give me an error. I really have to save the file and clean it up when I'm done. Okay, I could continue editing or I could abort everything what I have done. But here we save and clean up. Notice the change of color. Yes?
That stage, is it doing already quantum mechanics?
No. Yes. No quantum mechanics, nothing at all, right? It only calculates nearest neighbor distances from the structure input, and eventually if I would have given a space group, it would have generated automatically all the equivalent atoms. Okay, no quantum mechanics, just structure generation.
Excuse me.
Yeah?
What is the old scheme and the new scheme?
That's the way we choose sphere sizes. The old scheme is just only here for compatibility with older calculations. Don't use it. It is
better scaling between titanium and carbon, for instance, now in the new scheme, and that's what you should use. Yeah, it's a slightly modified. Yeah.
From TIC is known. If it is unknown, we can use the space group.
If you know the space group, of course, yeah, you put in the space group. Yeah.
It is not known.
Yeah, you have. If it's not known, the structure, you have to define a structure. I mean, right? If I don't know what titanium carbide is, I only know it has two atoms, so I would test sodium chloride, cesium chloride, I don't know, some zinc blended structure or blah, 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 Woodside structure. So I would test a couple of structures and hopefully find then by total energy comparison what is the best structure. Right? That's clear. Okay, whenever you have finished the structural input, please verify if it's correct. That means look at the structure. Oops, this is the right button here. We are using X-crystal, then an external program, and yes, you can nicely see a sodium chloride structure. Okay? In more complicated cases, I really would recommend that you click here on distances and click on two atoms and look at the distance. That should agree with what is in a paper or so, and therefore you make sure that you didn't mistype an atomic position or a lattice parameter or what else. Okay? Good. Just for educational reasons, I could change this and I go to the primitive cell mode. Remember what Heinz told you in the morning lecture? The lattice usually is a primitive lattice that would be the smallest possible unit cell. And if I go to the primitive cell, this is my unit cell, or these are the atoms. I could also switch on the crystal cells like this. So, a face-centered cubic lattice has actually this rhombohedral cell as a unit cell. But if I show you this, nobody would recognize that this is face-centered sodium chloride structure. Right? Therefore, we can switch here in the display between primitive and conventional structure. And then you are back into the cube. You also see this connection. It was via the room diagonal from here to that point where the primitive cell was shown, right? And here you can see, yes, that is maybe, is probably face-centered cubic. And this cube would contain four carbon and four titanium. So it's four times as big as the primitive cell. Internally, we do the calculation, the primitive cell, so just for one titanium and one carbon. But for convenience, of course, you want to specify the coordinates in a cube and not in this stupid rhombohedral lattice vectors. Okay. Let's close this. Next step, initialization of the calculation. Again, two different modes. There is a fast mode, and at least for all known crystal structures, I very much recommend that you use the fast mode. Only if you are using supercells or handmade cells, then you may do this initialization step by step. Okay? I will explain later on what are the steps, but you could do here in the individual mode, step by step doing these things. The danger is if you miss one of these steps, you are dead. The calculation will not work, right? Therefore, this is to some extent dangerous, but it is necessary if your structure is man-made, is self-made, because these first programs here, the first three programs here, may change your structural input and form automatically the smallest possible unit cell. So if you define a unit cell which is too big or not correct, these programs will convert that to the proper unit cell. And therefore, then you must do this. In our case, we don't do this. We will use the fast node. And we check here in the input the most important calculational parameters. So the first is this small button, select spin polarized calculation. Should I do this? Should I select it? No, why not? Titanium carbide is, of course, non-magnetic solid. So for which solid would I click here?
Iron.
For PCC iron, exactly. Yeah? So you have to decide yourself, do I want to make a magnetic spin polarized calculation or not? By default, we don't do it. But if you would do it, you can do it also for titanium carbide. It would converge to the non-magnetic solution, so you get identical results, but at a much larger computational cost. The SCF cycle would take many, many cycles really to get zero moment, and it's useless in that sense, right? We could also, again, reduce sphere sizes, don't do this. There are basically very few input parameters which determine the quality of a calculation. One is, which exchange and correlation potential should I use? As Heinz has shown you, with different versions, you may get different answers for certain properties. So therefore here, you should think about what you choose here. By default, we use the PBE GGA. So if you specify nothing, you will always do PBE GGA calculations. Okay? You can later on also change this again after the initialization, no problem, but just think about if you want to do PBE, do nothing, but if you want to do something else, you may specify. Another very important parameter is this RKmax. By default, it's set to 7, and RKmax means what is the product of the smallest Muffin-thin sphere times Kmax. I'll come to this in a moment. Just click later on this button. You come to our homepage, to a frequently asked question page, and it will tell you for which element you should use which RKmax. If your smallest element is hydrogen, an RKmax of 3 is sufficient. If your smallest atom is uranium, you better use at least 8 or even 9 as RKmax. Okay? And in this table, which you get by clicking on that, you find what is the proper value. The important parameter is the RKmax of the smallest sphere size. And remember, the smallest sphere was our carbon here. It's the small sphere, the titanium is the big sphere. Okay? So let's go in between again. The next important parameter is down here, the K-mesh. The K-mesh, the Brillouin zone integration, determines the quality of your calculation also. It's very hard to predict what is a good K-mesh. There are a few rules, general rules. I'll discuss this later on also. But for certain properties, like NMR in metals, you may need here 1 million or even 2 million K points. For other properties, a structural relaxation of a medium-sized cell, even 1 K point is enough, absolutely enough. So you have to get a feeling, and since you don't have it, if you are a beginner, it means you definitely should check all your results with respect to K point and also to RKmax. That means we are always doing at least 2 or better even 3 calculations. The first one with a fairly small RKmax and a fairly small K-mesh, save the results, plot a density of states or whatever, and then redo the calculation, continue with the calculation with a larger RKmax and a larger number of K-points, and compare the results. And only if no change appears, you're safe and this result can be published. Okay?
So here we do nothing. We just take the defaults.
So what about the temperature then?
This is temperature smearing. So by default, we are using the tetrahedron method. I'm talking about this. And I will also make some comments about temperature smearing later on. Okay? That affects how we calculate the Fermi energy, basically, and the occupation states for metals around the Fermi level, this parameter. Yeah? I'll comment on this later on. Yeah?
I think RFT reduction by X percent.
Yeah.
In addition to what you've already said?
No, that would be again from the nearest neighbor distances.
Okay, so it would override.
It would override what we have done before. Yes. Yeah. Therefore, usually I don't do this anymore. Yeah. No, K points do not depend on Archimax, of course. No. No, these are two. This basically depends: do I have a metal or an insulator, and do I have a small unit cell or a big unit cell? I'll discuss this later. Yeah. So, if I click once, you see it checks your input. Your input seems to be okay, and you can now start the calculation, and you have to click a second time. It will check that you don't make unreasonable choices over here. If you put something very wrong here, it will not allow you and give you here in red some message like whatever. You can try it out if you want. So we do the batch initialization. It tells you here what is the command which you could also enter in a command line. So this command init lepw minus batch and w you could put on a command line also. Enter it in. Yeah? So from learning, you learn here how you would do the same thing as instead of Win2Web on the command line by typing in commands. And it puts the input in a file standard out, and this, the output into standard out, and this we can watch on. So standard out says the first program is NN. It calculates again these nearest neighbor distances, the two spheres, titanium and carbon, atom 1 and atom 2, sum the distance to 3.84, and that is the sphere sizes sum to that. And this is less the nearest neighbor distance of 4.06. So here you check again whether your atoms are equivalent. First of all, it's trivial here. You may get in unknown structures, man-made structures here, an error, and you should not continue if you get here some error or warning messages. The next program is called S group, and S group calculates for you the space group. So now we know the space group, it's 225 FM minus 3M. Of course, if you would put that in, hopefully the same would come out. Here we did not know the space group, but the program tells us this. S group can also do very important other things, namely it would automatically reduce your unit cell to the smallest possible unit cell. Okay. The next program is called symmetry. It determines the symmetry operations and adds them to the structure file. If there are no errors, don't worry. Next is L start. Now is the first quantum mechanical program running. This is an atomic code running the individual titanium and carbon atoms. Three atoms, neutral, three atoms with a default configuration, atomic configuration. And you see the output of this program. Titanium has those orbital. Okay. You see, may see here a 2p star and a 2p orbital. This is because this program is a fully relativistic orbital, and 2p star and 2p refers to 2p one-half and three-half states. We will hear from Javier later on about relativistic effects, spin orbit coupling. So therefore we have two different p orbitals, and you see there is a big change in energy of half a Rydberg or so because of spin orbit coupling, which is taken into account. At the end here, you see for each, here you see the energy of each of these orbitals in the free atom, and here you see the charge of such an orbital within our atomic sphere. So obviously the 1s, 2s, and 2p states, they are fully confined within the atomic sphere, and therefore these are core states. Core states set to true, even if this is 9888. And here you see the 3s and 3p orbitals, which a chemist would of course also say this is a core state. But that's not completely true. As you can see, there are some fractions, one hundredth of an electron or so would, or a few hundredths of an electron would leak out of the sphere, and therefore we define this as force. This will be band states, we will recalculate them, let them interact with the neighboring atoms and form bands, even if a chemist would call this a core state. Then there are the real valence states, the 3D and 4S in titanium. You see here the occupation for spin up and spin down. And of course, in total, we should have four real valence electrons, two up and one up, one down for the S. But in the total valence density, also the 3S and 3P will be included. This will later on be important when we plot valence electron densities, because in the valence electron density, also those states would be included. But we don't want that. We will later on cut these states away before we plot the actual valence density, because otherwise you see just that there is an atom. The core density or the density of this 3s and 3p would show nothing except that there is a huge, huge electron density at the site of this atom, which we know anyway, and wouldn't show anything, would hide all the details. Okay, carbon is much simpler. 1s is the core, 2s, 2p are the valence states, and you see that here we have only 50% of the charge inside the sphere. Notice, for instance, in titanium, the 4s electrons, only 0.1 electron, so 10% are within the atomic sphere, everything else is outside the atomic sphere, right? So this makes the interpretation of a 4s partial charge very difficult, because there is no s charge inside the sphere. Anyway, if there are no errors, you can continue. Yes, of course. Yeah, RMT is the sphere size. Exactly. If we shrink the sphere sizes, these numbers will change. Exactly. Yeah. So therefore, charges within sphere are not absolute numbers. They're just relative numbers which you can compare. If you do two calculations with the same spheres, then you can compare them. If I do titanium carbide and titanium oxide, and I use the same titanium sphere, then I can compare the two charges and say, okay, in titanium carbide I have more charge than in the oxide, or something like this. Yeah? Otherwise, these are meaningless numbers. Don't calculate the ionicity from these numbers.
This small star, what is this?
This star? Yeah. That is the P, for P electrons, it's the P 1/2, and for the D electrons, it's the D 3/2. And 3 and 5/2. So this is spin orbit split at P and D states. Okay? Next step is K-gen that generates my K-mesh. By default, we use 1,000 K-points. That means we divide our unit cell into a mesh 10 by 10 by 10. This gives me 10,000, gives me 1,000 points. This is this 10, 10, 10. And then we apply symmetry, and instead of 1,000 K points, we reduce this number of K points to 47 K points in the irreducible part of the Brillouin zone. I'll discuss this also later again, but this is the number you actually calculate, will use in the calculation. This 10 by 10 by 10 mesh is the mesh which defines, so to say, the, your mesh, because this reduction depends on the symmetry, basically. But this 10 by 10 by 10 is the density of the mesh you apply. And the last step is called D-start. That takes now the atomic densities of titanium and carbon, calculated in this program here, puts them on the lattice sites, and makes a superposition. Okay? So here we generate the first crystalline density, which is a starting density of my SCF cycle. If there are no errors in this output, always please look at this output. There can be easily errors either here or in the symmetry programs or so. Then you have done something wrong or something needs to be done. If there are no errors, as in this case, you see a finished okay and you can continue. And we simply continue to the next point, and that is run the SCF cycle. Okay? So this gives you many options which you have here. For titanium carbide, in, by default, we don't need to set anything. Most importantly, maybe, is to select convergence criteria. If you want to have better convergence than the default, you could, for instance, add another zero here in this energy convergence. I will not do it because it only takes longer time in the demonstration, we will not do this, and then we start the SCF cycle. Okay? Again, here you see the command which we actually have executed. It's called run LAPW minus energy convergence, this number, minus no initialization, no extra initialization, minus NI. That you could also type in on a command line instead of clicking on this button, and you see here this color has changed, it's running here, but that is updated only every 20 seconds or so, so this may not always be up to date, but you can now view the standard output, and you see we are now have done a cycle of programs LAPW 0, 1, 2, core and mixer. So these programs, and we'll discuss it, show it again, calculate from the density the potential, both the Coulomb and the exchange and correlation potential. LAPW1 will now calculate in this potential our block wave functions for all the K points, calculate the eigenvalues and the wave functions. LAPW2 will take this, calculate the Fermi energy, and calculate the valence electron density. In this change potential, we recalculate all the core states in the program core, calculating the core eigenvalues and the core density, and mixer adds up the valence at core density and mixes it with the input density, taking a certain fraction of the previous density combined with the new density, or after a couple of times of several previous densities, and combines and forms a new density, so that hopefully we reach self-consistency in a small number of times. And if I reload here, and I will here reload in reverse order, because then I see it over here, so it is now, as you can see, in cycle number 9. It gives you here a hint how far convergence has been reached. Energy reach, convergence is still a zero here, so it's not done because we have only two zeros and a two zeros and a one. So it will take two or three or four more iterations until it finishes. Instead of this standard out, I can click on utilities and show also standard out, but also something which I call the day file. The day file is very similar to this, what is in standard out. So you see these individual programs. But in addition, you see when the calculation has been started, the time, and you see how long each program ran. This would be the CPU time here. This is the actual wall clock time. So LEPW0 took 4 seconds and 8 tenths of a second. This took 2.6 seconds and so on. You can see here also a fraction, like 150%, meaning apparently this program has used more than one CPU. It has used almost 2 cores for longer times, for longer calculations. You will see here values close to 200%, because we have set up the program such that by default it may use 2 cores simultaneously. From such an output, you can estimate how long your calculation will take. You see, this cycle started at 11, 21, 24, and this finished 15 seconds later. So that means if I estimate 10 cycles or 15 cycles, it will take 200, 300 seconds or whatever until this SCF cycle is done. If you see that your first cycle took 1 hour, then probably you better go for lunch or even go home and sleep, and next day hopefully you have the results. Okay?
So what will that show, FTD out, or what will this extended show, FTD out?
Standard out, yeah. So I can switch between this view, then I have this view, and now it has stopped after 11 cycles. Okay? There is a stop already now here. Or I click again on the day file. Same information, but with timing. And if I go down to the 11th cycle, I also see cycle 11 and stop. Yeah?
How did you define convergence back?
I did it here, right? Run anyway. Here, convergence criterion, energy with this value. Okay? I could use charge distance, which is the difference of the integrated charge density input and output charge density, absolute value and integrated, giving me, so to say, the number of electrons which has changed from one iteration to the next one.
So essentially you have to have a sensitivity about this.
Yes, yes, yeah. You see, we supply here some defaults, which are medium quality convergence criterion, let's call it this way. It depends very much again on the property you are interested, what you want to look up, if you need to improve these numbers or not. Okay? You could always continue, right? I mean, if I want to continue, if I find this convergence is not good enough, I go in SCF cycle, I would put a better convergence criterion, add here another zero, for instance, and continue. Start the SCF cycle again. Yeah? Okay? No problem to do this. Don't do the SCF cycle if you changed anything else except the convergence criterion. So when you change from LDA to GGA, you cannot continue without what I will call a save. I will show you this in a moment. Okay, yeah?
When you are repeating the once again the self-consistent calculation, it will overwrite the previous
No, it will append the data and continue. Okay? You also saw, if I click on this, you saw this error message here, or this warning here. It tells me burden files exist from previous SCF cycles, right? The burden files contain the charge history of all these 11 iterations, and they are used together with the new density in the next cycle to calculate a new, a better SCF density. And this is good, so you would say run anyway if you just want to continue and do a better calculation, better convergence. If you would change something like K-points or ArcMax or LDA to GGA or whatever, you should not continue, but you should first save your calculation, or if you don't like this calculation for some reasons, at least remove these files. Okay? So never change anything in your calculation and having these files. The convergence will be very bad. You may get ghost bands or whatever, all kinds of things, because the mixer doesn't know. He finds very nice convergence,
And suddenly he gets a very different density because you have changed LDA. What should, it doesn't know how to mix these things. He gets crazy or so, right? So you have to remove the history, and history means you have to remove the Brayden files or save the previous calculation. If you just want better SCF convergence, then you say, run anyway, put the better criterion, either you can also specify two at the same time. You cannot specify the fourth criterion for titanium carbide because all the positions are fixed and you cannot move atoms. If I would do it, the program is even clever. If I specify it, I run it, I view a standard input. It says force convergence not possible, force is not present. Okay? So it tells you this, that forces cannot be calculated, but so you should not do that, of course. Okay, so we have done this, and in utilities, after the SCF cycle has been finished, you should analyze your result. That means you should look if convergence of some numbers has really been reached. What numbers are important? The total energy, for instance, discharge distance, the difference between the input and output charge integrated. We can also look here, for instance, at the charge density within the spheres of both atoms. We will analyze the file titaniumcarbide.scf with 10 lines, or if I want all lines, then I put a large number, whatever, then I don't get only the last 10 iterations, but all iterations which I have. And if I want, and I'm a graphics fan, then I can click on this graphics button. Okay? You could also analyze another SCF file or whatever here. If I do it like this, I get an output like this. The total energy as function of number of iterations is changing a lot, but apparently it's then converging. The charge distance, in the first cycle we had a charge difference of almost one electron, so there was one electron shuffled around basically nearly, but of course this goes to zero, and the charge within the titanium sphere was reduced from that value to a smaller value. And again, you cannot take the absolute values. This is meaningless. That depends on the sphere size. But what can I know from the fact that this charge has decreased? And for carbon, the charge from start point, from the free atoms, to the self-consistency has increased. What do I know from that information? That means this bonding must be at least partly an ionic bonding, right? So there is some charge transfer from titanium to carbon. Don't specify this number and say it's a charge transfer of 0.2 electrons or whatever, or 0.2 electrons or so. That's not correct, because this depends on sphere sizes, and a lot of charge is in the interstitial, so you don't know what it is. But you can define the direction, and again, if you do a series of different compounds with the same sphere sizes, you can see where is a bigger and where is a smaller charge transfer. Here you have the numerical results of this graphical output, so you see the total energy accurately. Important is check that you just see stars. If you see here warnings or so, you should look why there are warnings. Some warnings are not important, but sometimes these warnings indicate that something is not good. Okay? Here's the charge distance. It tells you for which atom the largest difference occurred. And then this is the total or the average of these two. And then the charges inside the spheres. Okay. When we are happy with the convergence, then we always click also on the fourth point here, on the fifth here, two on the fourth, yes, and save the calculation. So how should I save the calculation? I would save this calculation and indicate the most important parameters of this calculation. That means I would save, I don't need the name titanium carbide because it's obvious. In titanium carbide, it's hopefully a titanium carbide calculation. But I should probably save and say for which lattice parameter it was, which volume. Suppose I haven't taken exactly the experiment, but you could put in here experiment. Then you would say RKmax was the default, RKM was 7. Then you would say 1000K, and then you would say PBE. So these are the three or four parameters which, so to say, describe a calculation. For which geometry have I done it? Here I was lousy, I put just experiment. You could also put the lattice parameter or whatever here. What was my plane wave convergence, the number of K points, and what was the exchange correlation potential? Okay, once I have saved this, it saves the structure. CLM sum is the self-consistent charge density. It changes other, saves other files which are here not relevant. It saves also all the input files and this SCF file where the basic results are stored basically of this SCF, like the total energy or so. These quantities you find in this SCF file. Okay? All the input files you find there and so on. If I now would change the input files, I could go here to input files, and if I want to change a potential, remember the potential was calculated in which program? 0, 1, 2, 0. So the input must therefore be in 0. Okay? And here it says XEPBE, and if I want to do an LDA calculation, I put, for instance, LDA, XELDA instead of PBE. I save the file and I could run another SCF cycle. Okay? And saved, and the calculation is LDA result. If I want to restore my PBE calculation afterwards, I go again on utilities and here is a restore button and I would restore this calculation, pasting it over here, and restore all the input files and the self-consistent density and so on as a regular name. Okay? I hope this feature is clear. You see, in files, we have many, many files. We got even more files now. For instance, in input files, just to see this, I have this titanium carbide in zero. But I also have, because it lists only the titanium carbide files here. If I click on all files somewhere, I don't see all files. Don't know why I don't see. No, then it goes down again. There should be an all files usually. Here, this is show all files, probably this one. No.
So what's the same problem?
Yeah. Okay. The problem is that this doesn't fit on the screen. This is overlay, so if this is too long, it doesn't fit on the screen. So with better resolution, you don't have this problem. You could also change this in change, where is it?
Configuration.
Configuration, yes. In change configuration, you could click on short JavaScript menu is this one. Save these values and pick this and select titanium carbide. Now you see this looks a little bit different, more like Java buttons. People who like this, they get this. And if I see now files here, then here is an all files. Yes, we can see this. Then you see also standard out, for instance. But you should also see at the very bottom, so you see really many files. You see all these files experiment with this name, also with all the input files. Running calculations is always done with names titanium carbide dot something. Saving under a different name, you get these files here, but you can always restore, copy them back to the original name.
So this Java interface gives the same result?
Yeah, sure. This is just...
It looks more friendly, actually.
Yeah, okay. This is rather... Blah, blah, blah. If you are a Java fan and a Windows fan, then you like this. Okay? The problem is here, you see nothing at all. That means all the tasks are... You don't see... You always have to click on execution until you see a few tasks, but not the main ones. You see more, right? But not the main ones. So, yeah, this is how you configure it. You can use it as you like, yeah? Okay, I will leave it now for you. Okay, good. So, once we have saved the calculation and we are happy, we go to tasks. We can calculate the electron density, density of states, various spectroscopies, which I will not demonstrate today, and the band structure. But we will do a density of states, electron densities, and band structures. The basic tasks of every electronic structure calculation in a solid. Let's start out with the DOS, and let me make one remark. Do the band structure always at the last step, because this destroys the eigenvectors and you would have to recalculate the eigenvectors again. Because this you do in a different K-mesh and then you cannot get a density of states on that K-mesh. So let's start with the density of states. First, there are optional steps and necessary steps. So the necessary you have to do, the optional you can do. And the program tries here really to give you a hint. So read these buttons. It says edit this input file. Why would you do this? You specify a larger energy max at the bottom of this file. By default, we calculate only the states which are occupied and the few unoccupied. In a density of states, for instance, in absorption spectroscopy, you want the unoccupied states. In order to get them, you have to edit this input file. And at the bottom, you put here a min, a max. You increase this 1.5 to 2.5 to 3 to 4 to 5 Rydberg, depending on how high you want the density of states over there. Whenever you change something here, you have to save it. And of course, when you change something, you should run the corresponding program. This is just the input. You could also prepare a different K-mesh. Often one wants to calculate the density of states on a finer K-mesh than the self-consistency, because otherwise your DOS looks very spiky. With a better K-mesh, you get a more smooth looking curve. When you change the input, you have to run the program. And optional other points, I'm not discussing this here. Necessary step, run these QTLs. That means calculate partial charges. I'll discuss this also in detail later on. And now we need an input file for the density of states, and we can configure this or we can edit this by hand. Let's try to configure it. We want to calculate, it tells me here which atoms I have and which charges are available. We want not only the total density of states, but we want to decompose it according to atoms. 1 and 2, but also into S, P, D, or what is called here EG and T2G contributions. Everybody knows what EG and T2G is?
Crystal
field, right? We have D electrons on titanium, and the cubic octahedral crystal field splits the 5 D orbitals into 3 T2G and 2 EG levels. WIEN2k knows the symmetry automatically. So if you do a hexagonal stuff, you will get here a splitting of P into PXY and PZ. In cubic, you don't get the splitting because PX, PY, PZ must be the same. So you only can plot the P density of states. And you would get a different splitting eventually for low symmetry, all 5D orbitals, which you get individually charged densities out. Yeah? So WIEN2k will change this according to the symmetry for your specific case. And you should now count if you want to plot specific values. And if I now copy that, I hope this is working. Well, I expected that. This mouse is, I'm not too used to it. So, dot. Okay, so let's type it in, comma. For titanium, what density of states would I plot? The total of titanium, of course, but then the main electrons of titanium would be d electrons, right? And probably I want a decomposition into this EG and T2G, so I put D EG, comma, D T2G. When this atom is done, I make a space and I specify the next atom. Second atom, space, I want the total, comma, no space, and carbon, I specify S, comma, P. Does it make sense to put D? Not, of course, yeah? This is your task. You have to know which element has S, P, D, or F electrons, which you want to plot, right? The program does not know that. So let's execute this and go again into this density of states and look what input file has been generated. This input file in the second line gives me an energy grid saying I will plot the density of states from minus 0.5 to 1.5 Rydberg with a step of 2 millirydberg. Then it tells me I will plot 8 different density of states, or calculate 8 different density of states. This is this 8. And then follow 8 lines over here, which gives me the atom. The first column, 0 means total dose, 1 means first atom, 2 means second atom. And the second column, a 1 in the second column means total, so this 0, 1 means the total dose, a 1, 1 means the total titanium dose, a 1, 4 means take the fourth column. Where do you see the fourth column? Column 1, 2, 3, 4. That's the DDoS. Column 5 and 6 is EG and T2G. Carbon, second atom, 1, 2, 3 means total S and P. Okay? So I hope you understand from this. It gives you here the header, which column corresponds to this. And this is not unique. This depends on the side symmetry of your compound. What is listed here? So after P, that could be PX, PZ, or something incoming. And then 5 or 4 is not the D density of states for another compound. Always count here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And then you know what you are plotting. If you have more atoms of the same type, so suppose we would have 2 titaniums here, I could use those inputs here to combine the dose of titanium 1 and titanium 2 to a total titanium 1 plus 2 density of states or so. Okay? These lines here at the bottom
would do this, but then you have to change the zero, this number of summations, and give here which lines you want to combine. It's described in the user's guide.
Can you write like total burn?
So I can add the total titanium and carbon dust, and I would here put a one, because I want just one summation. And I would say total is second line, 3, 4, 5, 6. I would put 2 and 6 here. Then I plot the sum of total titanium and total carbon. I don't know if this makes sense, but would be an example. Yeah? But in some more complicated compounds, you may have 3 different oxygen atoms, and you may want to add all these 3 oxygen atoms. And then you would say one line, but 3 summands, because you have then 3 oxygens, and you would put 3 lines here. Okay? It's not difficult, I think. This. Yeah?
Did you change the Emax before, or did you cancel that?
I changed it.
So, but here we have 1.1.
Yes, yeah.
Changes into 2.1.
No. These are different things. First, with this changing of 2.5 or so, I calculated eigenvalues up to 2.5 Rydberg.
Okay.
Here I'm saying, in which energy range do I want to plot the density of states? Only up to 1.5. Okay. Yeah? But the difference is, for this density of states, we need full bands. I can calculate the DOS only for a full band. That means if I have at high energy somewhere a band coming down, it is maybe at some K points below this 1.5 Rydberg, but not for other K points. I have no eigenvalues if I haven't calculated them. And then it will not calculate the DOS until 1.5, but to the minimum of this unfilled band or half-filled band only, right? And then it does not plot the DOS until 1.5, but to a lower value eventually. So whenever you see a DOS which is not as high as you expect, there are 2 places which you need to change. One was this in one file and recalculate LEPW1, and eventually then change this number to a higher number if you want this. 2 places. Okay, if we haven't changed anything, we don't need to save it. We just can continue, of course. So once we have prepared the input file, we run the corresponding program, tetra. Therefore, it was INT for T for tetra. We can look at the output. I will do it very briefly. So you see here which types of density of states you were reading. You see here a nice listing that is the band limits that gives me the minimum and maximum energy of certain bands. So there is a band at minus 3.3 Rydberg. Which state do you think is that?
Yes.
This is the titanium 3s state, this core state, we usually would the chemists call it, but we calculate it also. These are the 3p states, these 3 bands here, and you see the band dispersion is very, very small. So this S band, for instance, has a dispersion of 7 or 8 millirydberg. It's changing from 9 to 1 over here. The P band has probably a larger dispersion from 667 to 627, so 50 millirydbergs. So it has a certain width, but it's still fairly small width compared to real bands. So for instance, this low-lying carbon 2s band has already a width of 0.25 Rydberg, right? So these are the real bands, and the others are core states, but they have an interaction, therefore it's not one energy, but a slight splitting, a slight bandwidth occurs. Yes? I know it because I'm a chemist, a good one. Yeah? Good question. We will analyze it later on. So for these core states, the low lying. So these three for these examples here. So everything below minus one. This you know really from the output of L start. Okay, from this initialization program, which we ran, where we discussed and said, 3S was at minus 3, and 3P states were at minus 1.7 or whatever, Rydberg. From this, you identify that. Okay? The other states, we don't know. This was because, I know the output, maybe. You cannot know it if you have no experience. Here, we will do this now with the density of states. Okay? You find here a listing now of the energy, the total dose, and on the side, the integral of the total dose. Okay, so there is no density of states at this energy, apparently. This is maybe also important. Remember, in the input, minus 0.5 Rydberg. So compare this with these band limits. Is this a meaningful input? Probably yes, because there is a big gap between minus 1.6 and minus 0.15. So we will not plot the density of states of these first four bands. Okay? Because these are core states. We are not interested in them. But we will calculate the dose starting from those bands. If you aim in the 0.5, included in your dose. Now, here you see now at some energy, it's minus 0.1 or so. Here, the density of states starts to be non-zero, and on that side you see the analytic integral. So don't integrate the dose yourself with some numerical integration scheme. This is very lousy and very inaccurate. You get here the analytical integral of the dose up to a certain energy. This will be the total. This would be total times you have specified in the input, and somewhere will be a Fermi energy. You see the number of the first bands was 2 electrons. In the first band, there are obviously 2 electrons, therefore this is constant here, and the dose is zero again, and then again the valence state starts, and at some point I get these 8 electrons somewhere, and that should correspond to my Fermi energy here, where I have 8 electrons, and I immediately see from that I have a metal, the dose is non-zero, and if I go all the way down, you can also get the specific heat coefficients gamma from corresponding to this density of states. Okay, looking at this is nice, but better is to plot it. We have a couple of interfaces. One is this DOS plot, and the first plot I want to do is I will plot the total density of states, the total titanium, and the total carbon. So I'm clicking on these three buttons here and say plot. And then I get the dose like this. Yeah, and obviously we have these low-lying bands. The energy scale has changed here. This is now in electron volts. Zero means the Fermi level. So the Fermi energy is very close to this minimum in the dose, but it's still metallic. And apparently this low-lying band here has mainly carbon character, small titanium contribution. Here we have both carbon and titanium, but carbon dominates overall. And over here in the unoccupied states, titanium states dominate. Of course, these are the unoccupied d electrons of titanium which dominate in this energy region. Okay, now why is this D? Who says that? I have said that. How should I know? Okay, so let's further make another plot. You can produce a PostScript file and so on. Yeah?
Why the plug-in solution blue line, green line,
green line, I think that should be equal to red line.
Yeah. No, because what is missing? This is the charge inside the sphere. So what else do we have? An interstition. And lots of electrons, typically, in a bad case, even 50% or so of the electronic charge is outside the spheres. So the sum of these is not the total dose. Okay? You would plot also need to plot the Q out, the interstitial density of states, which cannot be decomposed to atoms. Because a charge between two atoms somewhere, to whom does it belong? To atom A or B, who decides that? These are plane waves, so I have no idea where it belongs. Okay?
Yes, yeah? When you want to calculate the US, you use the X, etc. This etc. based on the Bloch correction, or is it something different?
The Bloch correction, you mean? Yeah. Yes, it uses by default the Bloch correction.
And here, energy also is with respect to the Fermi energy, which does the total energy.
This is with respect to the firm energy. If I plot it in EV, I can also plot it in Rydberg. So let's change this EV to Rydberg, okay, and plot it. Then I get my original Rydberg scale. So now you have Rydbergs, and you see the states at minus 0.1 to 0. This is what we looked up, this number before, the band ranges, and that was what I called the carbon S band. So far we only need it's probably a carbon band because carbon dominates this. Yeah? So in Rydberg you get it in absolute units. But typical convention is that the Fermi energy is set to zero and one plots this in electron volts because you want to compare this usually with experimental spectra. And this is always in electron volts. Yeah? So this is a convention which has been taken over, but you can plot them in both ways. Yeah? Rydberg, that would be the original energy units where all the eigenvalues are given in Rydberg, or by default, we have electron volts and shifted the scale such that the Fermi energy is zero. Okay? You could change here the energy ranges for plotting. I mean, don't publish such a plot, okay? Because you should start probably at, I don't know, minus 0.3 or so and remove this part. And don't believe the value of the dose of this spike. This is a useless number here, right? Because you would need a tremendously good K-mesh to believe such a Van Hove singularity, the dose of this value. With a different K-mesh, a different energy grid, you may get a very different number here. So one would make a good plot by rescaling this probably to, I don't know, 60 or so, and this energy range only from here to 1.5, because it's meaningless to show zero dose here just because it's not calculated. It would indicate it to somebody, there is no dose, there is a gap, which is not true, right? So don't publish this plot as it is. Yeah? Think what you are publishing.
But Peter, going up to 1.5 is also not so good because perhaps we have bands that are missing.
Sure. Yeah, but here it's okay probably because we can check this in the output file. Show full menu. In the output T file, it tells me, so you see, it can, with this input, eigenvalues, we can calculate all the density of states up to 2.8 Rydberg in principle, because this is the minimum of the last full band. We have higher eigenvalues, up to 3.2 Rydberg, but the DOS would be okay only up to 2.8 Rydberg, yeah? With this number of electrons. This number is, so to say, the important cutoff. So. Good, and of course we can also plot now a partial doses, which tells me which that is, and I will decompose the d density of states
into EG and T2G and put carbon S and P. Okay? In this interface, you can plot up to four lines in one plot. And if I do this, I get a plot like this. So now I know, yes, this is carbon S, because this is clearly dominating, right? And you see a small contribution here, and this is DEG. But I don't see any T2G. Can anybody explain me why I see only EG and not T2G? Carbon atom, titanium atom. So this is carbon S, we said, right? An S orbital. Titanium EG are d orbitals. You all know these orbitals. They could look like this, right? Should be the same everywhere. Or they could be in 45 degrees, pointing like this, right? So with which of these two orbitals can an S orbital interact? With the top one. Why? Because let's say S is plus everywhere, and here I could put plus, minus, but here I have plus, minus. And obviously the overlap of such an orbital is finite, but an overlap with such an orbital, plus and minus, must be zero. And therefore this is an EG orbital, and this is a T2G orbital. And therefore, in the DOS, you cannot have, if this is only S character, you cannot have any T2G interaction. And it shows you how much the contribution in the wave function, or here is the square, the charge density, of a carbon S orbital with this DEG type orbitals is. So there is a small contribution, but obviously this is very small if you compare this compared to that. And the same is true here. So it's dominating carbon P. We call this therefore the P band. But there are also titanium compounds, contributions. And here are both. I see an EG, which is dominating, but there is also a T2G contribution. So with P orbitals, we could have a carbon P, schematically like this, plus minus, and if here is a T orbital, this can make a nice covalent bond with an EG orbital. Okay? But P could also be here like this, and this cannot interact with this EG, but that of course can interact with a T2G orbital and form which kind of bond? How is this bond called? A pi bond, exactly. So this is an example of a sigma bond. This is an example of a pi bond. And apparently, we find here a domination of a sigma carbon P titanium EG bond, but there is also a pi interaction between carbon and the titanium T2G orbitals. Above that, we have the T2G orbitals dominating, at the beginning no carbon at all, then there is a small or very little carbon contribution. And at even higher energies, you see the unoccupied EG orbitals, right? And of course, with the unoccupied EG orbitals, there is again some carbon contribution, some larger carbon contribution in there. So how can I understand that? In terms of a molecular orbital picture, you know all these two atomic molecules. Now we explain titanium carbide as a two atomic diatomic molecule. So I have carbon, the p states of carbon, okay, and I have the titanium atoms. And from the atomic levels, you will find that the d states of carbon are a little bit higher in energy, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 d orbitals of titanium. And these five, they split into this EG and T2G, right? And with carbon P, they can form a strong bonding orbital like this. And if there is a bonding orbital, there should be also an antibonding orbital, right? So this is the P, D, EG, sigma bond. But we said the P also interact with the T2G, but obviously the overlap will be smaller than with a sigma orbital. That leads to a smaller splitting, something like this. And therefore also the antibonding state will be at smaller energy over here. And this will be the P, D, T2G pi orbital. And here the corresponding sigma star and the corresponding pi star orbital. Okay? And eventually there might be even non-bonding T2G orbitals, which more or less lie at the same energy as in the free atom. And this is what is dominating here at the beginning, where almost no carbon is interacting. So what you can refer from this analysis of the doses, here you have the bonding carbon-titanium D interaction, here the antibonding, and since the carbon EG is stronger bonding, the antibonding is shifted to higher energy because the splitting will be larger than the split. This is exactly what you can read out of this. Now I have all told this you. You can also visualize this in terms of density of in terms of charge densities. We will now plot the charge density of the valence electrons. But in the lectures, in the exercises, one of your tasks will be to plot not the regular valence density, but also the density of electron density of certain parts, energy regions. So if I say it's antibonding, that would mean if I plot this part, then the density between these two atoms should clearly be almost zero, go to zero. While if this is bonding, the density between these atoms should be finite. And you can really plot in Wien very simple this electron density, or let's call this one, or this one, and you will see the correspondence to exactly this analysis which I have given. Yeah? You can even select single K points and then really plot a pi orbital. This depends on the symmetry, and find these pi orbitals, bonding or antibonding, or a sigma orbital bonding and antibonding like this. Good.
I could say there are some aspects in my lecture which I didn't show it in. Titanium carbon is also shown. It's the electron density. Where you see this from the electron density, you also have the metal-metal bonds, titanium-titanium, which also forms bonding and bonding states. But some of the pictures are at the end of my lecture, which I didn't use.
You will do for titanium nitride these pictures yourself in the exercises where you see all these kind of, you can see part of this analysis. So next step will be, we are plotting an electron density, right? So I click on electron density. First thing is, we said we want to get rid of these semi-core states, the 3s and 3p states. And with this step here, I can put an energy minimum, or I could also put a maximum, so an energy range, for which energies I want to calculate the new charge density. So by saying a min minus 1, I'm cutting away these four low-lying states that we don't want to show. So let's run this. Good. Now we have to define a plane in which we want to show the density, and we do this by looking at using this X-ray stand again. We do a 2D DOS. I put this on the side, something like this. Usually I click on the first button here, or first point, and this is a grid number which we want, a grid, how many points we want to do, let's say 100, something. And then I want to click on three atoms spanning a parallelogram. So if I do this, I can click on three atoms, one, two, three, and click such that there is a 90 degree angle for the middle atom. Yeah? So one, two, three, not one, two, three. That would be wrong. Say selected, and a rectangular parallelogram, and you see the plane we have selected. And with this plane, we want to calculate the dose. You could, of course, now also define a 110 plane or a 111 plane by clicking on the corresponding atoms. There is one more thing, namely, when you choose this plane only, this fraction, you would never see a full atom, but only a quarter of an atom is visible. So we want to enlarge this a little bit, and for this we put here 0.5 everywhere. If I just do it once, you see what it does. It enlarges the plane by half in this x direction in this way. And if I do this in all three cases, and update this display, this is the plane which we will actually calculate, and by doing so, we really see the full atoms later on, okay? And not just a quarter of an atom as before. So I submit that. This prepares an input. Here I could also make a difference density later on for spin densities or things like this, or for difference densities. I click on OK, and the new window again, I move on the side. I want a colorful plot, so let's make it rainbow, and I say submit, and I see a little bit, but most likely not very much, as you can see. Now, what is disturbing? The big spheres. I don't want them. So let's click here on the side and make the spheres either very small or even vanishing at all. That's up to you. I leave here small spheres. So we start to see something. What else is bad? These bonds. I don't need these bonds. I don't want them. I modify the ball to stick ratio, which by default is 0.6. Either you put a small number, then you get small bonds, or you put zero and say OK, and then this is gone. Okay, and you have your plane bonds. So I have already something, but I'm still not very happy because I don't know what it means. So let's make a thermometer and submit it. This resolution of the screen is a little bit low, therefore I have problems to show everything. But you can see the color range should go from red all the way to blue, and I have no blue, basically, so this is not well chosen. And to fix this in a better way, you go here on ranges, and you change the maximum, which is, has chosen automatically, but the maximum is at the nuclear position. That is, you don't want that. And you put here a small number, 0.5. And submit again. And now I get a much better density. Apparently, I'm still having no blue here. So let's reduce this further to 0.3. Submit it. And now I have, let's say, a quite decent density of states. Which atom is titanium and which is carbon? The big one is titanium, you're saying. I would disagree. No? Remember the valence, first of all, number of valence electrons. Carbon has four and titanium has four, but we have said there is a charge transfer, right? So carbon must have more. Now, clearly, this atom has more than that one. One hint. Second hint, carbon has s and p electrons. But px, py, pz in cubic symmetry must be the same. That means in carbon can only have a spherical density. That must be spherical. this plot, compare this plot with my funny pictures, which one is dominating? Here is the maximum, blue is the maximum. So you see here this leaf over here. So this is EG, that is dominating clearly and forms the covalent bond, higher density in this direction than towards the metal here, or even between carbon and carbon, a covalent, nice covalent bond between these and these atoms. Okay? That's what you, how you compare this plot to the partial density of states we have done before. And if I now would select a different energy range, I could get a very different plot, plotting the density of only, I don't know, the unoccupied EG orbitals that would dominate, and here would have zero DOS and only very little carbon DOS, for instance, this example, something like this. Okay?
In those dark red areas in the semi-reckoning, how much of, what's the electron content that would be integrated? Is it very much at all?
The integrated charges we already looked, that was the CTO, remember? So this was according to our sphere sizes. You don't see the sphere sizes in this plot. You would have to measure the distances, and you know the sphere sizes from the structure file and could draw a sphere somewhere. It would be a big sphere for titanium and a small sphere for carbon. So the sphere of titanium would probably be up to here. And this would only be the carbon sphere, something like this. And that you see again, these integrals are of course not very meaningful numbers in that sense. We have another method, I'll mention this tomorrow or in the afternoon briefly, tomorrow most likely, where one could do a better decomposition.
Because it looks like you just cut them off halfway between, you know, pretty much the electron density goes, but you got those rectangles in the middle, and that's kind of the only...
Yeah, I mean, yeah. That's the way it is. Okay, good. You can print this with print crystal, produce a plot out of this. If you want to print it really, you can click here and get a different background. Otherwise, you waste a lot of back toner, of course, if you plot it like this, and make it full screen such that it is filling up and doesn't show all these kind of things. So by selecting it here and then moving it properly on the side, right? With these buttons, you can move this up and down, and you can arrange it properly and get a nicer picture out of this and plot these pictures, so to say, something like this. No? Okay, exit this, and last but not least, I will briefly show you a band structure so that we have finished this. Band structure means some energy versus some path through the brilliance zone. And here X-Crist then can also be used to show you this. Just close that stupid window. And here you see now the brilliance zone of a face-centered cubic lattice. And you click on a couple of points, for instance, in the center of this hexagon. This is apparently an L point. I go to the center of the unit cell. This is apparently the gamma point. And I go to the center of this square here. And this would be called an X point. I could also go some other points, take some other points or so. Just let's do these 3 points. I say OK. And I say in this path, I want 100 K points. OK. And I save it. And it says, tells you here, save it as xchristen.klist. xchristen.klist. And save it. Okay, we go again in band structure. And now we select here from xchristen. There would be also in WIEN2k an FCC K list by default. You could also use this one, but just let's use this from xChristen, and I click on create this band structure. Then I run the eigenvalues on that specific K mesh. Will take a few seconds. And I'll also do this XLEPW minus band minus QTL for band character. I'll explain to you what that is in a moment. Then we need an input file for the band structure program where it says insert the correct Fermi energy. So the Fermi energy is apparently this number, and that must go in where these X's are. 7, 6, 5, 1, 1. Why I'm doing this not automatically? Now, if I would have many calculations, I don't know which Fermi energy I should put in. If I have an LDA and a GGA calculation, different volumes or so, they would all be listed here on the side. But you have then to know which band structure for which case you are doing it. Here it's trivial, we have done only one, right? I save it. And let's make immediately a band character plot. That means I want to emphasize in the band structure now the states of titanium character, first atom, and chromium 5 means 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the EG band of titaniums I want to emphasize with a sphere size of 0.2. If I want larger spheres in the plot, increase this number. So I'm saving this. I'm calculating the spaghetti program. And I'm plotting the band structure like this. And then I see there are 5 bands, which I see here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, which I don't understand because I expect 8 bands. If I look here, I have a little bit more, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, still not 8. Why not? Because some of the bands are degenerate. Okay? So you see there are more bands originating here. There are 2 bands. For me, it's hard on this screen to see. So we have here 1. So this band down, this will be again our carbon S band, right? You see the S free electron behavior near gamma. It's a nice parabola, like in the free electron case. At some higher energy, it turns over here. And these are the P states of carbon, 3 bands it should be. And then 5 D states, 5 bands of titanium D character, I expect. And of course, they intermix strongly. But still, EG is dominating at this high energy, or down here in these bands here, you have also some EG contribution. So with this tool, the band emphasis, you can also emphasize which character a certain band has. You could repeat this for the theta G states or for carbon S and P, and make then the carbon S band as large spheres or things like this. And with this parameter, you can always change the sphere sizes to make it bigger or smaller. Depends so that you get a nice plot.
Can you show actually the color code for this? Can you show the color code which cannot be known?
The color here has no meaning. Okay, there is one possibility. First of all, in the input, I could select a different color code. Color switch, this line 4 here, and it's described over here. If I don't do a multicolor plot, I can also make a black or a one color plot like this. In principle, if I have it, it would indicate me the irreducible representation, this number 4, and that is what we will do. So I also calculate now this program XIREP, which calculates for each eigenvalue the irreducible representation. So it makes a group theoretical analysis. And if I now recalculate the spaghetti and plot the band structure. Now the colors make sense, okay? And indicating that the same color has then a certain irreducible representation, okay? So here, when you have this IREP, then the band, the colors make sense. You can in an output file of IREP look which irreducible representation that would be. So you know, you might have seen something like a gamma 1 or a gamma 1.5 or a gamma 2.5 prime or things like this, such stupid labels which have certain meaning. And this is in the output of IREP described, but it's not listed here on the plot, not on the plot, because usually there is no automatic way to label this. You would have to label these points then by hand yourself with a graphics program and putting that in. Yeah? In the output program of IREP, for each of these states, the irreducible representation is listed. And you have to look that up if you want to do this. Good. Any other questions?